Good morning. So I am starting this one. Basically, title is Instrumentation System and Signal Conditioning Circuit and MEMS-based accelerometer. It is basically MEMS-based capacitive accelerometer. So in the first half, I will briefly describe about the instrumentation system and signal conditioning circuit. And the second half, I will describe about the MEMS-based capacitive accelerometer. So this is a basic instrumentation block diagram. So the instrumentation system is basically consists of a sensor and transducers, and then an amplifier, it's maybe a low noise amplifier, and then a signal conditioning circuit which will process the signals from sensors and transducers, and then some digitization and data conversion will be there. So after that, it will communicate with the external world. So there will be a power management, so which will supply the power to the associated blocks, and the embedded controller, a memory, or other things are there. So these sensors is basically maybe a temperature sensor, maybe a process pressure sensor, maybe some X-rays, rays detection of like that. So the sensor will give a output, so that may be a mechanical output, maybe an electrical output, and the sensor signal is basically a weak signal. Weak signal means the signal strength is very low, so its amplitude or frequency or other things will be very low. So after that, so there will be a low noise amplification, or here maybe it may be a buffer kind of thing. So the sensor output, which may be an electrical signal, may be a mechanical signal, so that will be amplified or buffered. Then after that, there will be a signal conditioning and filtering circuit. So this signal conditioning and filtering circuit will include an amplifier, a filter or other associated blocks. So this is a biomedical instrumentation system. So in biomedical instrumentation system, so there may be some ECG signals, and after that there a data acquisition system is there, and pre-processing, and after getting that signal from the ECG, so the information extraction will be there and some interpretation will be there. So this is the same block. So after getting the ECG signal, there will be a amplifier or filter, and after that there will be the digitization of that analog signals. So now the basic, what is a signal? Signal is a varying pattern that conveys some information. So the signal may be a function of time, signal may be a function of space. So all the signals is basically signal should have a finite signal value. So there the signal have some finite energy and power, and it has a limited bandwidth. So for instrumentation signal, so that pressure signal or temperature signal or some other signals, so their bandwidth is very low. The signal is basically the bandwidth is limited to 5 kilohertz or 10 kilohertz signal, 10 kilohertz frequency. For biomedical signals, the signal frequency is even if very low, it is within 5 hertz or 10 hertz kind of thing. So signals are broadly classified into two categories: analog signals, so they have continuous amplitude and defined for all time instants, and digital signals, which have discrete amplitude at specific time instants. So there is a brief description of this analog, discrete and digital signals. Here you can see analog signals is basically, this is a completely analog signal. It is continuous in amplitude, it can take any amplitude, and it is continuous in time also. So at every time instant you can get an amplitude of this one. And discrete time, so discrete signal is basically continuous in amplitude, but it is discrete in time. And digital signal, it is both discrete in amplitude and discrete in time also. So for digital signals, so it have so it has specific digital signal levels depending on your digitization steps. So it is here. It is a simple block diagram of a signal conditioning circuit. What a signal conditioning circuit means, and which are the major blocks in the signal conditioning circuit. The first one is a ADXL50. This is a capacitive accelerometer chip, and it is basically designed by Analog Device. This is a Analog Device chip. So ADXL50 is a capacitive accelerometer. So its range is around plus minus 20 g. So plus minus 20 g of acceleration it can detect. So in this chip you can see. So this is a sensor. It is basically a capacitive type of sensor. So due to the acceleration, the capacitance changes. And after that, there is a demodulator, is a preamplifier, and there is a buffer amplifier for giving the output. And there is a oscillator also. Oscillator is basically a square wave generator. So in this case, there is a square wave generator, so which is so used to excite the sensors, and then from the sensors we can get a signal, and that will be processed by the demodulator and the preamplifier. The preamplifier amplifies the signal what we are getting from the demodulator. And this block diagram is a thermoelectric infrared detectors. So this is a IR sensor. From this sensor, so we get the input signal. After input signal, it is modulated by a square wave. The fchop is the square wave. The square wave modulates these input signals, and after that there is a preamplifier, is a band pass filter, and the output modulator. After that we get a final output signal. The major components we here in any signal conditioning circuit is basically so IO buffer, so input output buffer. So in case of input, it is a input buffer. In case of output, it is output buffer. And then a amplifier and a filter and modulator or demodulator. These are the major blocks which are in any signal conditioning circuit. So first we discuss about the low noise or low offset input output buffer. So this input output buffer is basically a negative feedback op amp. You know op amp? I think so. So if you connect it in the negative feedback, so whatever the input it will play as the output one. So the standard specification of the input output buffer, its gain should be unity, and its noise level should be very low. So because, so if it is a input buffer, so it will be coupled to the sensor, so the sensor signal will be very weak. So it means it may be weak in amplitude. So to detect the sensor signal, so that buffer to noise should be very less. So this buffer noise will determine that how minimum voltage level or signal it can detect. So this input buffer noise should be very less, so it will be around nano volt range. So its input impedance, should be very high. So here you can see, so in case of an op amp, if it is a CMOS op amp, so this is essentially a the MOS device. So you know the basic configuration of MOS op amp. So MOS op amp, the input stage is a differential amplifier. So here you can see, So this is the one configuration of standard two stage op amp. So you can see the input is basically the gate of the MOSFET. So if it is a gate of the MOSFET, then so no current will flow through this or this arm. So you can say to its input impedance, because input impedance will be the voltage for whatever the Vin is coming here and the current is coming, current it is drawing. So its input impedance is very high. So this input impedance should be very high. So in case of any input buffer, because so if it draws current from the sensor, so then the sensor voltage or whatever the sensor output may be attenuated or kind of thing for the to due to the loading effect. So essentially for this input buffer, this input impedance should be very high. So in case of the input buffer, and its output impedance should be very low. So because it will drive some circuit, so it can draw current, meaning it can drive current to the load. So its output impedance should be very low, in the range of some ohm or kilo ohm, maximum kilo ohm. So its bandwidth should be moderate, in the range of megahertz. So because whatever the signal is coming from the sensor, so it will pass to that signal. So its bandwidth should be to large enough to bypass that to buffer, so that signal which is coming from the sensor. And so its the offset should have been in the microvolt range, and it should be a low power, and it can drive that high capacitive load. So this driving capability is basically the essential properties of the output buffer. For the input buffer, it may not be needed, that driving capacity, because this buffer will essentially will connect to the some other block of the signal conditioning circuit. So this block may be a amplifier kind of thing. So this amplifier will also be a CMOS amplifier. So its input capacitance will be the gate capacitance of the MOS at the next stage. So its gate capacitance, so you to know probably the gate capacitance of a MOS will be in the range of some femtofarad. The femtofarad means 10 to the minus 15. So if it is a femtofarad kind of load to which it is driving, so its driving capability may not be so much high. So it will not draw the more current from this one. So that input buffer, that driving capability may not be the essential condition for this input buffer. So, but for output buffer, so the output signal goes to some other IC or some other outside block. So it will be the output to some other to IC for the post processing kind of thing. So therefore that output buffer driving capability should be very high. So it will supply current to the load. So the design issues related to this input or output buffer is like that op amp. So here this configuration is a two stage op amp, or op amp is connected in negative feedback, and the op amp loop gain, open loop gain should be very high to reduce the offset. So how this offset, input offset is related to the open loop gain? So essentially this is a buffer. So open loop, if you say, so this is an open loop op amp. So how this input that offset voltage is related to the open loop gain of this op amp? So how it is related to the open loop gain of this op amp? So it is connected in negative feedback. If it is V in, then this will be V out. So the things is that open loop gain high, enough to reduce the offset. So if open loop gain is very much high, then offset will be less. So you can analyze this circuit. Basically, so for the op amp, the two terminals, non-inverting terminals and inverting terminals, you say, so this voltage difference, so what the main target is, the Vin should be equal to V out, or V out should be equal to V in. So there will be, so if, so these two voltage must not be same, must not be same means, so there will be little bit difference between these two voltage. So depending on this gain of this open loop, the op amp. So if the open loop gain is very much high, so the difference between this V in and V out to be less. So the V in and V out, so that open loop op amp is in the range of the gain of the open loop op amp is in the range of 1000 means it is around 60 dB gain. So you can see, so this difference in voltage should be less, so if gain is too much high. So to reduce the offset, so its open loop gain should be very much high. So if gain is less, you can get a much difference in the input and output voltage. For less noise, so it should be design of PMOS input differential pair. So I think you that MOS basics you have to understand. So that PMOS transistors, PMOS transistors essentially contribute less noise with respect to the NMOS transistors. So that's why, but one disadvantage is that, so the PMOS transistors is little bit slow than the NMOS transistors. The mobility factor of the PMOS transistors is about one third of the NMOS transistors. So for instrumentation applications, so you don't need high frequency kind of things. So the instrumentation signals are limited to around 5 kilohertz of signal, 5 kilohertz of frequency. So that's why you can to build this CMOS op amp with PMOS input differential pairs. So that will reduce your noise, and there will be a sufficient current in the output stage to drive the load. This is the condition for the driving capability of the output buffers. So now the amplifiers. The amplifier standard specification or gain should be in between 10 to 10,000. The non-linearity should be less than 0.1%. So non-linearity in terms of in response of the gain. The CMRR should be around 100 dB. CMRR is common mode rejection ratio. So here also the noise should be in nanovolt level. So it should have the high input impedance, so like the previous one, and low output impedance like the previous one to drive the load. And its gain bandwidth product should be around 20 megahertz. So it should have low offset and low power also. So gain will be within 10 to 1000 according to your requirement. So basically it can be a programmable gain, so you can program the gain according to your need. So whenever the signal, sensor signal may be weak, so you can increase the gain, and when the sensor signal may be strong enough, so you can reduce the gain according to your needs. The non-linearity in the gain should be within 1%, and the CMRR is basically the common mode rejection ratio. So whenever the common mode rejection ratio is the ratio of the output voltage due to the common mode signals, divided by the output due to the differential signal, that I will describe later. So types of the amplifier, it may be the DC signal or maybe the AC signal. So depending on the sensor output, may be a DC one, sensor output may be a AC one, depending on the change in the process parameters. So it may be a voltage or current amplifier, both. So it may be a transconductance amplifier. A transconductance amplifier is essentially the input is a voltage and the output is a current. And trans impedance amplifier, the input is the current and output is the voltage. So based on the architecture, we can divide the amplifiers. The single-ended amplifier. Single-ended means that input is a single-ended signal, and output is also a single-ended signal. So it may be a differential amplifier. The input is a differential signal, the output is a single-ended signal. So you can get Vin plus and Vin minus. So there are certain advantages of using the differential amplifier. So it will cancel the systematic offset or the common offset present in Vin plus and Vin minus. And so as a fully differential amplifier is also fully differential amplifier means it input is also differential, the output is also a differential signal. And a special type of amplifier, it is an instrumentation amplifier. So instrumentation amplifier, in case of instrumentation amplifier, this is a special type of amplifier. In this case, this input impedance and CMRR, and here I forgot to mention one PSRR is there, power supply rejection ratio. So that is very high for the case of instrumentation amplifier. So first of all, this non-linearity. So if it is a transfer curve of a sensor, so this curved one, so not the straight one. The straight one will be the digital output. So if it is a amplifier response, so then the digital output should be like the straight line one. So its gain is the slope of this straight line. Then this curved one is the actual output what you are getting from the amplifier. So here that non-linearity is basically at certain point, so it will be the actual output minus calculated output by the rated full scale output range. And CMRR is basically the change in output voltage by the change in common mode voltage. So little bit about the CMRR, common mode rejection ratio. So if it is a differential amplifier. So this Vin plus and Vin minus will be a differential signal. So differential signal means it should have a common mode, and with respect to common mode it should change like this. And Vin minus, so the common mode, it is, you can say, VCM, and with respect to common mode it should change like this. So this Vin plus and Vin minus should be in opposite phase, and this V out, if it is differential gain is AD, so this V out will be equal to AD. AD is the differential gain, Vin plus minus Vin minus. So here you can see, so this will be AD into, so this differential voltage, if you see this amplitude, is Vd by 2, and this amplitude is Vd by 2. So then VCM plus Vd by 2 minus VCM plus Vd by 2. So it will be around Ad into Vd. Vd is the differential signal. So here you can see the VCM, that common mode voltage. Common mode voltage is cancelled out due to this differential operation. So if it is a single-ended operation, this V in and V out. So this signal will be composed of VCM and so let it be Vd. And its amplifier gain, if it is AD, so then V out will be AD into VCM plus Vd. So here you can see, so due to this common mode, the voltage common mode, so this output voltage is consist of both common mode voltage and the differential voltage. So here in this one, in case of differential amplifier, this common mode voltage is getting cancelled. So this is one advantage of the differential amplifier with respect to the single-ended amplifier. This common mode rejection is basically, so your common mode voltage, so this differential voltage is due to the change in sensor output. So due to change in sensor parameters, so maybe a pressure or temperature kind of things, so your this Vd will change. So, but this common mode is not due to the actual sensor signal. So if this common mode changes, so your output should not change. So this common mode is due to some biasing circuits. So for VCM, so if VCM is the common mode, so nowadays this CMOS circuit is basically a single supply circuit. Single supply means it is VDD and the output is the ground. So in previous cases, so there was a plus minus supply. The op amps you generally 741 or like that, so they have a dual supply, the plus minus to 12 volt or 14 volt kind of things. So nowadays this CMOS op amps are like this, they have a single supply. So now for CMOS 180 micron 180 nanometer technology, the supply voltage is 1.8 volt. So you can go up to 3.3 volt, but the standard voltage is 1.8 volt. So whatever the process is in our lab, so it is a national process, national semiconductor process. It is 180 nanometer process, that is 0.18 micron technology, that minimum length you can take, that is 180 nanometer, and the supply voltage is limited to 1.8 volt. And it may go up to 3.3 volt, but the standard voltage is 1.8 volt. So there is no negative supply, that is to minus 1.8 volt is not there. So the supply voltage is 1.8 and ground. So for this case, so if you want to bias some circuit, some op amps, so your common mode voltage should be VDD by 2. That is at 900 millivolt. So now this common mode voltage, so this is the standard one, you can change this one, this may not be a 900, it may be a 600 millivolt kind of things, but standard thing is 900 millivolt. So this VCM, it is preferred to keep the VCM at 900 millivolt. So your differential signals which you are getting from the sensor output, so that should vary with respect to 900 millivolt. So this VCM in the negative input, VCM is also same, it is 900 millivolt, and the input signal which is coming to the amplifier should vary with respect to 900 millivolt. So now what will happen, so if this 900 millivolt changes, so for this 900 common mode voltage, so your output voltage, the amplifier output common mode should also be at 900 millivolt. So this is the normal biasing condition. So whatever the signal will change, it will change with respect to this 900 millivolt. So if V out will also the amplified version of this input signal. So it will so change with respect to 900 millivolt. So now this VCM, so let VCM, so the preferred VCM is 900 millivolt, but if it is changed to 700 millivolt, so your sensor signal which is coming, so this is changing, this is changing with respect to 700 millivolt. So your common mode voltage changes, but if your common mode voltage changes, your output voltage or the output common mode should not change. So this is the common mode rejection. So if your common mode changes from 900 to 700 millivolt, so your output common mode or output voltage should not be affected by this input common mode change. So how this amplifier will reject this change in common mode? So that is the CMRR, common mode rejection ratio. So change in output voltage, so due to change in common mode input voltage. So if your basically input common mode is 700 millivolt, your output common mode should be at 900 millivolt. What was before? So when it was, the common mode voltage was 900 millivolt. So if your input signal is changing with respect to 700 millivolt common mode signal, so your output signal should change around 900 millivolt common mode signal. So this is the common mode rejection of this amplifier. So there should not be any change. So due to the change in the input common mode, the change in the output voltage should only be because of the change in the input differential voltage. So input differential voltage means if this Vd by 2, so that input signal is changed, so your V out should only be changed for this Vd, so not for VCM. So here you can see the V out is basically, so there is no term in terms of VCM, but ideally this is the ideal calculation, but practically there may be some changes. So if the input common mode change, so how it will reject this input common mode changes? So this is the common mode rejection ratio. So here you can see, so this common mode is maybe a DC one, maybe a AC one. So there are basically some specification is DC common mode rejection and AC common mode rejection also. So if this common mode has some particular frequency change in common mode, so that is the AC common mode. So now this amplifiers is ideally consists of op amps. So this open loop op amp, the ideal operational amplifier. So here you can see this is VCC plus and VCC minus. In this case, for CMOS op amps, the VCC minus should be grounded, and VCC plus may be 1.8 volt, may be 3 volt, may be 5 volt kind of thing. So for the ideal op amp, that input current should be 0 in both of the inputs. So that's why it will give to high input impedance, and input that should be no limits. So these are for the ideal cases, and V to IO, that is current, to RI, that is input impedance, should be to infinity, and I bias, to bias these op amps, should be 0, VN. So these are all the ideal characteristics, but the practically, so this all has some limits. So this IB value has some value, it is around some microampere range. This VN, it is in the nanovolt per root. the CMR is in the around of 60 dB or 20 dB kind of things. This output is also limited, the output current what it will supply, so it has some limit also. The slew rate, it is infinite, but it has limited to some extent. So this is the ideal characteristics of an op amp. So this is basically a two stage operational amplifier. So this is the input stage and this is a diode connected load and this is the output stage, it is a source follower stage. So whatever the supply you will give, that is the incoming signal Vin plus Vin minus, so they are both can be differential. So now, so if this VSS is grounded, now so this Vin plus or Vin minus, so this is a NMOS one, so Vin plus and Vin minus, so they are to bias this these MOSFETs. So I am drawing only the input stage. So here can here you can see, so this is the grounded one. So this bias transistors, this V bias will basically, this bias transistor will supply the bias current for the input pair. So here you can see, so this bias current, this may be to IB or ISS, whatever. So this node, to may have to some voltage, so let it be VS. So this is the drain voltage of this transistor. Now, if it is Vin plus, so now you can see, so this voltage is the gate to source voltage of this transistor, Vin plus minus Vs. So if it is 0 volt, so whatever selling this common mode voltage, I am again coming to common mode or normal bias voltage, let it be V bias. So with respect to this V bias, you are changing the differential signal. So this V bias should not be 0 volt. So if it is 0 volt, so then so what will happen? This Vin plus minus Vs is less than 0. So this transistor will not on. So to on this transistor, whatever, so you have to give some voltage which is greater than the VTH, the threshold voltage, of this transistor. So this bias voltage should be to greater than VTH plus VS. So if this voltage is VS, then this voltage is VTH plus VS. So then the gate to source voltage of this one is only VTH. So it will just on. So now to support this bias current, so if it is IB, so in normal biasing condition, so in this branch it will be IB by 2, In normal bias condition means to both the, if it is VCM and if it is VCM, and the transistor operating in saturation region. So if these two voltages are same, so the bias current of IB by 2 and IB by 2 both will flow and both will be the same, that I am saying. So if it is VTH, the gate to source voltage, so then it will be just on and it will not support any current. So it is just on. To support this IB by 2 current, so this V to V in plus or V in minus, so this biasing voltage should be to greater than VTH plus VS, means so this V to this gate to source voltage should be greater than VTH plus this voltage is called some V on. So this V on is basically to support this current. This VTH is basically to make this transistor on, and this V on, or sometimes it is called V overdrive voltage, VOV. So this voltage is to support this IB by 2 current. So whatever the input signal here, so let this common mode signal is common mode or bias signal is VB. So here in V in minus, it is the normal biasing voltage, and the input voltage will change like this. And then this current, so in this one, so it will to change in opposite direction. If this voltage increases, current will increase, and so if this voltage decreases, current will decrease. So the opposite characteristics you will get in the current output also, this in two branch. So this is the first stage. First stage is essentially a differential one, differential that NMOS differential pair, and the second stage is the gain stage. So the total complete gain is basically the multiplication of first stage gain and second stage gain, and this CC is basically used to compensate the frequency response of this one. CL is the load. I think you have not read these things. We will go afterwards. So there are two types of operational amplifiers. So here, in this operational amplifiers, so here you can see, your input is the voltage difference, V in plus minus V in minus, and the output is also a voltage. So voltage input and voltage output. So this is the operational amplifier. So another is there, it is operational transconductance amplifier. So in case of operational transconductance amplifier, you can see the input is the voltage difference and output is the current. So what is the basic difference? So in this case, for operational transconductance amplifier, the input impedance is also same for both the cases, because it is the driving the gate of a MOS device. So input impedance should be high. The output impedance, in this case, output impedance is also very high for the operational transconductance amplifier. In the operational amplifier, the output impedance was low, but for this transconductance amplifier, this output impedance is also high. So this is the difference, and the current output. So here the output is current. In the previous case, it was the voltage output. In this current output, you can see the IG0 is the current output, or I out you can say is GM cross V1 minus V2. So GM is the transconductance of this transconductance amplifier. So your current will change according to the input voltage change and the transconductance of the circuit. And this bandwidth is infinite. It is bandwidth is very much high. So now your normal transconductance amplifier, you can see. For normal transconductance amplifier, what you can get voltage input, and you will get a current output. So, and its the output resistance, R out, is also very high. So this transconductance amplifier can be treated as a current source. So its output resistance is very high, and it will supply the current. So now, in the case of op amp, what we have seen is V in plus, V in minus, and it is the output voltage. So its input impedance, its output impedance is very low, and it will give the voltage output V out. So in this case, so this GM in case of this OTA, so this GM you can find as GM equal to pi out by V in. So depending on the change in the input voltage, your output will change. So now, so this OTA or op amp, this op amp is basically first stage. And see, this is a OTA, and after that, so there is a buffer. This is an OTA, and this is a buffer, and this, so this one a complete op amp. So this buffer, so this buffer will reduce the output impedance, reduce the output impedance of this OTA. Inbuilt this OTA's output impedance is very high, so if you include a buffer at the output of this OTA, so this OTA and this buffer will essentially build the op amp which will reduce the output impedance of the op amp. So there are some comparisons. First of all, op amp is a voltage source output, the OTA is the current source one. So because of this low output impedance, it can drive the resistive loads. In case of OTA, it can't drive resistive loads, you only can drive the capacitive loads. So in case of what? So this is the operational transconductance amplifier. So this op amp is essentially an OTA and the buffer, what I told before. So this buffer increases the power dissipation and noise. Then in case of OTS, this power dissipation and noise is less. Then in case of op amp, gain is independent of the feedback network. Feedback network will that op amp, so its gain is very much high. So it generally never used in the open loop condition. So as its gain is very much high, so it is difficult to control the gain of the op amp. So it never generally use in the open loop condition unless it is a comparator kind of thing. So if it is a comparator, it generally use in the open loop condition, because of comparator the output should be the rail to rail output. So it will be VDD or it will be the ground one. So in case of comparator, you can use an op amp in open loop condition, but for case of the amplifiers, it is generally used in feedback condition. Feedback means some resistive feedback, I think you know. So this inverting amplifier or non-inverting amplifier kind of things. So they generally used in the feedback configuration to control the gain. So this is the differential and common mode signal what I described before. So here you can see, this is the op amp, the VIC is the common mode voltage, and the differential voltage is VID by 2, and here also VID by 2. So VID equal to V1 minus V2. So it will be VID, and VIC, that is the common mode voltage, will be V1 plus V2 by 2. So it will be VIC. So now you can see, so here I think V2 will be VIC minus VD by 2, it is plus here. So the output voltage you can see, the V out will be the differential gain a VD into VID, differential gain into differential voltage, and common mode gain into common mode voltage. So for our case, to make this CMRR, to make this amplifier CMR is high, so your common mode gain, that is AVC, should be less. So it will be around 0. So if this common mode gain is 0, so then your output will be less affected by this common mode changes. So this is the single-ended signals by differential signal. This single-ended amplifier is basically, it is very sensitive to power supply noise, and so it exhibits common mode drift, which gets amplified. So what I told before, that due to the common mode changes, this single-ended amplifier, that common mode is also being amplified. So you can't detect that whether the output change is due to the common mode change or the differential change. So therefore, we have to use the differential amplifier. So in case of differential amplifier, so it is higher immunity to process and temperature variations. Basically, whatever the variation you will get in the both of these inputs, the V1 and V2, in both cases you will get that same variation, and that systematic variation or common variation will be basically rejected by this differential amplifier when it will be V1 minus V2. So here the higher immunity to supply and environment to noise, and its common mode rejection is also very high. So due to this differential signaling. So now there are some amplifiers. These are the single-ended amplifier. This is inverting amplifier. The gain is RF by RF by R1, and its gain is negative. That is equal to minus RF by R1. This is an inverting amplifier. This is a non-inverting amplifier. Gain is 1 plus RF by R1. So these two are basically a single-ended amplifier. So here you can see. So this is the V in, which will be coupled to some signals, and here you can see. So if this node, this non-inverting node is grounded. So due to the virtually shorted of these two nodes property of this op amp, this node should also be that virtual ground. So you can see. So if you give a input signal here, so V in, so some current will flow through this R1. So here you can see, so you are drawing some current from the sensors or some other source. So here the input impedance of this single-ended amplifiers are finite. So you are giving some signal and you are drawing some current. So its input impedance is finite. So it should be infinite for case of any amplifiers, but in case of single-ended amplifiers, so this is a single-ended amplifiers. So here its input impedance is finite for this one, and for this differential amplifier also, its input impedance is also finite. So if this is V2, so this voltage should be in between V2 and Vout. So it will draw some current. So this transistor here, through this resistor, some current will also flow. So here you can say that input impedance of this differential amplifier is also finite, but the common mode rejection of this differential amplifier is higher than this two amplifiers. So in case of this amplifier, if the common mode changes, so your current will change and your output voltage will also change for this one and this one also. So here you can see for non-inverting amplifier, the input impedance is high, because the non-inverting, so here you are supplying the input signal, to the gate of a MOS. So the input impedance of this non-inverting amplifier is high. So for case of the this case, for the differential amplifier, the input impedance is low, but the common mode rejection or power supply rejection is higher than these two structures. So this is a standard instrumentation, op amp based instrumentation amplifier. This is a three op amp configuration. So here you can see the gain is basically 1 by twice R1 by R gain. So here generally what happens, so this R gain is a variable resistor, so you can change so this resistor to get a variable gain. So in this case you can see, so these both of the inputs V1 and V2, or you can say V, so both are being applied to the input of a MOSFET, so its input resistance is very high. So as it is a differential in nature, so its common mode rejection is also very high. So in general cases for high end applications, generally common this instrumentation amplifier is being used. So this is the basic criteria for selecting the correct type of amplifiers. For differential amplifiers, the best for low, the gain is less than 100, and gain is the differential signal gain. So it is most commonly used to translate differential signal to single ended in presence of high common mode voltage, that is, common mode rejection is high. So you can use this differential amplifier where the common mode voltage may change, and it has relatively low input impedance, because so it is drawing some current is flowing through this resistor, that's why, so it has relatively low to input impedance. So this instrumentation amplifier, here high gain is possible, it is up to 10,000. You can get a linear gain and high common mode rejection and high input impedance. So for instrumentation the amplifier, you can get all the specifications. All the specifications can be fulfilled. So high common mode rejection, high input impedance, so high gain. So there are some applications of these amplifiers. So here you can see, so this is a strain gauge. Strain gauge is basically, so it is used to measure the strain. The strain is measured. So this is the actual strain gauge, and this is the complete the Wheaton bridge kind of thing. So due to the change in strain, this resistance of the strain gauge will change, and due to the change in this resistance, so your output voltage, this V out will change. So here you can see, so there are two differential outputs are there. So this must be coupled. So this must be coupled to a differential amplifier. So this is the application of some. So this is the sensor configuration. And from this sensor, so your output, this sensor output, so it will go to some amplifier circuit. So now this is a transimpedance amplifier. So this is a photo detector, and so due to the intensity of light, so your current through this photo detector will change, then this current will produce a output voltage. So your input is a current one, your output is a voltage one, so that's why it is a transimpedance kind of amplifier. So this one is a flow sensor. So this is the flow tube. So I think it may not be visible. So now, so here, so there are two temperature sensors. So are there? So one is the upstream and one is the downstream. So and this, so there is a heater. So it will heat the channel. So now, so if some flow happens, so here. So there will be a less temperature. So and here in the middle there will be the maximum temperature. So and here, so there will be some temperature change. So here you can get a temperature difference between so these two. One is the upstream one, one is the downstream one. So this temperature changes, change in temperature, this flow, the flow has been converted to change in temperature. So due to the change in temperature, so here you can get a change in resistance. So in the metal, if your temperature changes, your resistance will increase. If the temperature increases, resistance will increase. If temperature is temperature decreases, your resistance will decrease. So if you connect these two resistors, so in one case the resistor is more, and one case is resistance is less. So and in this case, if you connect to a Wheatstone bridge, the same type of signal you can get from here. So in one arm, so this resistance will increase, and in one arm the resistance will decrease. So it will provide a voltage output, that the output of the Wheatstone bridge, and this voltage output you can process through the amplifiers or filters. So now this is example of thermocouple. So this thermocouple is basically a temperature sensor, so which is consists of two different metals. So two different metals are joined together, and the one node is called, so when it is where it is joined together, it is called the sensing junction, and there is some reference junction is there. So this reference junction has have a particular temperature, the same temperature, then the sensing junction have a different temperature. So that is basically coupled to where you want to measure the temperature. So due to the temperature difference, some voltage will be generated in this thermocouple. So this voltage signal will be in the range of millivolt. So this voltage, what you are getting from this thermocouple, so you have to amplify it to get to determine the what is the temperature is there. So these are some sensor applications of the previously what I have discussed, the amplifiers and etc. So that is the application, sensor applications of those amplifiers. So the next thing is the filters. The filter is basically an electrical network which is basically have a particular amplitude that alters the amplitude with respect to the frequency. So if the input spectrum had two frequency with same amplitude or same signal strength, so if you pass it through the filters, so then what will happen, depending on the filter cutoff frequency, depending on the filter cutoff frequency, so if it is a low pass filter, so this chiffon will be passed, then the signal amplitude of F2 will be reduced. So basically gain depends, the gain of the filter depends on the signal frequency. So this is the low pass filter, high pass filter, band pass filter, then this is the filter characteristic that depends on the filter orders. Different types of filters is the Butterworth, Chebyshev and elliptic filter. Butterworth have no peaks in the pass band and stop band. The Chebyshev, it has some peaks in the pass band, and in case of elliptic filter, it has both in the pass band and stop band. So you can see the sharpness increases, but you are getting some ripples in the pass band and stop band in the elliptic filter. So the cutoff frequency or cutoff rate is very much higher in case of elliptic filter and Chebyshev filter, but you can get some sort of ripples at the pass band and stop band. So there are some filter specification. First of all, passive filters, you all know, I think, the active filters, so that composes of that op amps, then passive resistors, and the Salenki filter. So this is a special type of filter. So here you can get a simpler design and you can get a non-inverting output. And what? Break. Okay, 5 minutes. So now special types of GMC filter, I think, so you don't know GMC filters. You know GMC filters? So GMC is basically a transconductors based filters. So it is easy to implement. And so here, in case of op-amp based or active filters, so you have to use the resistors and capacitors to specify the cutoff frequency. So your passive resistors and capacitor determines the cutoff frequency. So now in case of GMC filter, so you no need to use those resistors, so only capacitors will be sufficient to determine the cutoff frequency. So in case of low frequency filters, low frequency high pass filters, low frequency low pass filter, so the capacitors and resistor values should be very much high. So if your cutoff frequency is less, then your resistors and capacitors values are very much high. So that may not be supported in your IC fabrication process. So if you are getting high value resistors, so then the area contained by those resistors will be very much high. And it will also dissipate the noise. So it will contribute more noise. So to avoid resistors, you can use these GMC filters. But in case of GMC filters, the accuracy to get a particular cutoff frequency is little bit less than the active filters. So one thing is that the switch capacitor filters. The switch capacitor filters, here you can avoid the resistors, but so you have to give an external clock. So the cutoff frequency basically depends on the ratio of those capacitors, and in IC fabrication process, the ratio of those capacitors to get the possibility of getting the ratio of the capacitor, the accuracy is very high. So that's why, so instead of using those resistors in the IC process where the resistor accuracy is very less, you can get 15 to 30% variation when you are fabricating the resistors. So if your resistor varies by 30%, your cutoff frequency is also will vary. So that's why to avoid those cutoff frequency variation, so you can use switch capacitors filters where the cutoff frequency depends on the ratio of the capacitors. The ratio of the capacitors you can get very accurate ratio in case of IC fabrication process. So there are some filter examples. These are the active low pass, multiple feedback high pass filter, Schellenke high pass, Schellenke low pass filter. This is the basic switch capacitor configuration. This is the switch capacitor resistor. So you can implement a resistor by using two switches and one capacitors. So here you can see the resistor value depends on C1, that is C, then the clock frequency. So this clock frequency is basically, so this clock are the switches. The switch operates due to that clock. So when S2 will be open, when S2 will be closed, S1 will be open, and S2 will be open, S1 will be closed. So this resistor value is, so you can get a resistor. So depending on the capacitor and the clock value. So there are some filter implementation. This is the switch cap filter. Here you can see. So this square wave, this clock is here to operate these switches. So this switch capacitor implementation need extra clock, but here here you can get accurate frequency. So this is a GMC filter. So GMC filter is basically cutoff frequency depends on the GM value, transconductance value, and the capacitors value of this of the transconductors. So there are no resistors in this GMC implementation. So here you can avoid the high value resistors to get a low cutoff frequency. So that will save your area and as well as the cost of those, the cost of the IC. So okay, fine. After that, in the second half, I'll discuss about the MEMS accelerometer.